Hey, what's up? It's Tom. Thanks for joining me. Luminar Neo has a free update, and I'm going to show you two of the new features. So in the upper left corner, you probably will see an update available. If not, go to Luminar Neo and check for updates, and you'll see the new update. And the two main things are merging layers and post-crop vignette. So let's take a look at both of those. So we'll just install the update and I'll come back when it's all done. All right, the update is complete. If we go up to Luminar Neo, click on About, we'll see the latest version. This is the version that has the merged layers and post-crop vignette. But before we get into Neo, let's take a little look about this photo shoot of Keira. Here's one of the original images. This was photographed in an office using a white wall. This makes a perfect background. It's great for headshots. It's a very clean, contemporary look. I love white walls because it's easy to make them gray. Here I'm just using one light. It was in Godox 8200 in a glow 34-inch beauty dish. And what Glow calls a beauty dish is basically a softbox. Now, you could get the same look using just a speed light and a white umbrella. So don't worry about cost. You don't need the latest gear. You don't need expensive gear. Simple speed light and a white satin umbrella to shoot through would give the same beautiful quality of light. It's the placement of light that's real important. Here I'm using butterfly lighting, and basically that's where light is coming straight down. So it's just above camera, and I'm shooting right underneath the softbox and giving us this gorgeous lighting. So I did use my Canon R5 for the shoot, but an older 85 millimeter lens, a 1.8. So I didn't adjust the exposure at all, left the flash alone. But on this image, Keira was about 10 feet off the wall and the exposure was 6.3. Then all I did was have her move closer to the wall. And you'll notice two things. One, the exposure changed a little bit because she's further away from the light source. So the exposure was F5. The light is a little harder. The further away, the smaller the source of light, the more the shadow is. But for textures, this actually works great, including the shadow on the background. It just adds a lot more depth when you're using textures. So I love the clean look for the headshot, but with textures, I think it does work to our advantage having shadows on the background. It just gives a little bit more depth and dimension. So let's get right to it and reset this image, and I'll go through steps on how I got this. So there's the original image. Again, Keira is probably about 2 feet off the wall, single light, and just a beautiful image. And take this image, go into Edit, zoom in a little bit. The only work that I did on this image is I sent it to Rebloom. That's what I use for skin retouching. And you can see the beautiful quality. All the texture is still there, but any blemishes on her face or body were removed by Rebloom. There is a link below if you want to give it a try. So when we get to the new features, I will be sure to point those out. But the first thing we're going to do is add a texture to this image. I'm going to hit Command 0 so we see the full screen. And the first thing you want to do with textures is create a sandwich. You want the subject on the bottom and on the top. And in the middle, we're going to put the texture. So basically, we're making a Keira sandwich here. Let's duplicate her by right-clicking and duplicate layer. We'll go into the layer properties under masking, and we're going to select background removal AI and let Neo do its magic. And it did a very nice job with the cutout. There's missing a little part of the tips of her hair down here, but that's not really a problem, especially when we're doing textures. So we'll click on remove, and it looks like nothing has happened. But if we actually turn off the lower layer, we now have the checkered board pattern showing that Keira is actually cut out from the background. So those are the two slices of bread for a sandwich, and now we got to put some meat in between, and that's the texture. So I'm going to hit plus and go to my images and grab a texture. When a texture comes on, it's going to be in the fit position. If we hit stretch, it's just going to change it vertically and stretch the square into a rectangle, a vertical rectangle. And that could be okay. A lot of times with textures, if you distort it, it's not really a problem. But that's not what I want to do. I want to keep the actual proportion to the image. So I'm going to hit fill. I'm even going to just bring it up just a little bit on the tops and bottoms to make sure the entire image is covered. And we'll change the opacity to 100. So right now we don't see anything. Next, we're going to take that texture and make our sandwich. We're going to put it between the two Keiras. And here we have a good start. But if you notice, we lost our shadow. But we'll get it back when we adjust the blend modes. On the blend modes, those are listed right here. You'll see the word normal. Ones that work great for white are multiply. Another one is darken, sometimes works, not with this image. And also hard light, gives a real more of a contrasty look. But ours wasn't a real white background. There was more gray to it. And great choices for gray backgrounds are overlay. That's probably my favorite, but if it's too strong, soft light is about 50% of the effect of overlay. Darken and screen can work well, and also hard light. For this image, hard light looks real nice, but I think we're going to go with overlay. The way this actual texture is working, it has darker edges at the bottom. So we don't get much texture on the top of the image. So all I'm going to do is go over to the layers property and click on flip vertical. And now we have a little bit more texture on top as well. So that is looking great. We got our sandwich going for us. We could call it good right here, but let's look at a few more options. One option is we could add more textures by going to our layers and picking out another texture. If you don't have any textures, just do a Google search for grunge textures or textures for Photoshop. You'll find a bunch of free ones. If you're having trouble finding textures, leave a comment below and I will do a search for you. Another thing you can do if it's too strong, one, you could try that soft light. That's about 50% of what the overlay looks like. But you can play with the opacity as well. But I'm liking how it looks. But if we zoom in doing Command or Control with plus, and then holding the space bar to readjust the view, we'll see there's a lot of sharpness to the texture. And we could blur that. So we want to make sure the texture is highlighted. Go to the creative panel and select blur. We'll do Gaussian blur and just take a look at the amount. Somewhere around 4 or 5 is looking pretty good. And we'll close up there. Let's zoom out doing Command or Control 0. See the full screen view again. And we'll notice there's a little bit of color on here. Sometimes when you do blending modes, it can change it. It could be in the actual texture file as well. If you don't want that color added, you can go to the Essentials panel and choose black and white and then hit convert. Next thing we're going to do is go back to the bottom layer. This isn't something that you need to do. I just wanted to show you that you can do it. And that is to change the color of the background. So by selecting the bottom layer, if we go to our essentials and develop, there's a couple ways we can adjust the color. Now remember, there's a cutout of Keira on the top, and then the texture that we created is a black and white in the middle. But if we change the color on the bottom, it's only going to affect the background. So one easy way to do that is with color and adjusting the temperature. We could make it blue, we could make it yellow, we could easily make it magenta or green, or you can do combinations. So if you want something a little bit more aqua, having some blue and green together looks great. Or if we want to do something purple, we have blue and magenta. And we can go orange with yellow and magenta. I'm going to reset those by just double clicking on the middle bar here to reset that. Another way is through curves. If you select, say, the blue channel, we can make it blue or yellow. In this case, I just want it a touch green. So I'll hit green and just bring that up just a little bit. And just have a hint of green on the image. So before the update, what we had to do now was export a file like this before we could go into vignetting or color grading the entire image. If we tried color grading this right now through our mood panel, all we would be affecting is Keira if we did the top layer, or the texture if we color graded it here, and the background color as well here. But we wouldn't have a uniform look because any color grading we did would only affect certain parts of our image. So what we had to do was, again, export it and then open up a whole new file that was created and then go from there with our color grading. With this new update, all we have to do is select the top layer, hold down our shift key, and click on the bottom layer so all three layers are selected, right click on it, and click merge layers. Luminar Neo is going to create a new layer on top that we'll be able to work on. And here is our new layer here. So let's go to our creative section and select mood and select a LUT. And what this does is just ties all three layers together because they'll have a similar color grading. So I'm going to choose a LUT. We'll go for cinematic toning. If we highlight one, we can use our arrow keys up and down to look at the different LUTs that are in the cinematic toning. All of them are really nice. I think for this one, we're just going with Los Angeles. And then you could adjust the amount of that LUT to make it stronger or weaker. The default setting worked great for me. Next, let's add a vignette and take a look at the new post-crop vignette and why that is such an important feature. So if we go to vignette and we add the vignette, we'll notice it has a nice vignette on the four corners of our image. If we go to the advanced settings, you're going to now see the mode and it's post-crop. But before this update, there was only a pre-crop. So the problem only occurred is if you cropped afterwards. So here the vignette looks great, but Keira asked for a social media one. She wants a square image. And if we do that and hit apply, we lost all the vignetting on the bottom and most of it on top. So I'm going to just hit Command Z, get out of there. We'll go back to the edit section and go back to Vignette. We'll go to the Advanced Settings and we'll change it from Pre-crop to Post-crop. So now everything is the same as before for the original ratio, the 2x3. But this time, if we go to Crop and we select a square format and we adjust that so it looks good and hit Apply, now we have the vignette on all four corners again. So that is amazing. I'm going to hit Command Z, get out of that. So that is the two new features, the merge layers, the post crop vignette. I hope you got a lot out of this tutorial. If so, be sure to give it a thumbs up. Consider subscribing to the channel. Click on the bell so you're notified of the next video when it comes out. Until then, keep shooting.